everybody, hello again. Nice to see you here. Nice to see you here on our next topic. Topic which is very, very dear to me, because if unit testing would have been performed in most of the projects, my work would be extremely easy and comfortable. So in the next session, you will hear about unit testing using ArchUnit, and our presenter will be George Dragomir, who is senior Java developer at ING Bank Romania. He is a versatile and professional software engineer, experienced in developing innovative and creative solutions. I told you, brain is for creation, and let's leave the machine to execute. He is able to perform full software development lifecycle activities and dedicated to streamlining processes and efficiently solving project issues. So what I extracted from his speech as a very important thing, which usually impacts all the projects, is that most of the time, documentation falls behind and becomes obsolete. And connecting to that, I will let George to tell you more about it. So George, the stage is yours.
Thank you, Victor, for the presentation. Hello, everybody, and welcome to Architecture and Design Unit Testing using ArchUnit. Before to start, I want to tell you that I'm glad to be here to GoTech, even from home. And now let's start the presentation. I will share my screen. Okay.
I can see your screen now.
Okay, can you see my screen? Great. So, architecture and design using ArchUnit. Does this picture look familiar to you? At the end of this presentation, we'll see that testing our architecture may not be so difficult like it seems the first view. The agenda for today is what is software architecture, why does software architecture matter, how good software architecture looks like, software architecture style, we'll go through a few styles of architecture, and how is the architecture documented. That is actually the main idea for this presentation. The first one, what is software architecture? There are a lot of difference for this word. The architecture is a broad term. The main one, it refers to decisions that need to be made early in the project, because once we implemented something, it's hard to change after. And it's also about the shared understanding that the people, the developers, have on the system. These words are by Ralph Jensen. And why does architecture matter? Like we can see from this picture, this is posted by Martin Fowler. The architecture can be misunderstood by customers and users. At the beginning of the project, like we can see from here, can be a fast process for a low internal quality code, but after a time, and this time it's measured in weeks, not months, we'll see that adding more feature to a low quality project is more difficult than a high internal quality project. And the craft that it's in our project is the main reason for this. So we should start with a good architecture from the beginning of our project. And how does good look architecture looks like? So here we have four pictures, and the answer to this depends of the point of time, because each of these construction was the best of their time. But what is more important, that architecture should sustain its evolvement. The architecture is in continual evolvement, so we should be aware of this. In software architecture, similar like in construction architecture, are different style there. We'll go through a few of them, the most important one. The first one, layered architecture or multi-tiered architecture. Like we can see in this picture, the request goes from up to down. And in the first layer, we have the presentation. The second one, application, where is the business logic of our application, domain layer, and infrastructure layer. What is important here, each of the logic, it's decoupled from the other ones. The request cannot go from bottom to top. The main advantage of this kind of architecture is that it's easy to implement it, the segregation of concern, but the main cons of this type of architecture is that in time this code could lead to monolith applications. Hexagonal architecture, where the core of the project it's separate from the external world. So this is split into parts, the internal and the external logic. The communication between these two worlds are made by ports and adapters. The port, it's an interface, and all the logic for an external communication should be made in the adapter. And the newest ones, the microservices architecture. And like we almost all of us knows about the microservices architecture, they are very easy to implement it. And also we have the ability to run each service in their own container. Also there are some disadvantages, like it's hard to test the whole integrated environment, because you should be sure that each of these services are up, and also you need to have more infrastructure to this. But we know there are more advantages than disadvantages. And how is software architecture documented? And this is the main part of our discussion. But first of all, why do we need architecture documentation? Because it's a starting point for interaction between different stakeholders. It is used for analysis and review of the project, and also for knowledge sharing between people that are working in different areas, but also for knowledge sharing for new colleagues that are coming in our teams. The question is when we should start to create and maintain a documentation. The answer is using this short formula. If the cost of the project without documentation extract the cost with documentation is greater than maintaining that documentation, so we should start to write a documentation for that project. And how this can be documented? By diagrams, the most usual ones. And like we can see from this picture, the standard C4 diagram. For more information, maybe most of you know this site, can go here to C4 model and find out more information about this. So at the first level, we have the system context diagram, where this is the big picture of our system. And also this could be the starting point of the discussion between different stakeholders. And this kind of picture also should be and can be shown to non-technical people. The second one, second C from the four, is the container diagram. Here we can see that we are seeing the main chosen for our applications and for what technologies we should use. This kind of picture can be shown to technical people and also to like programmers, architects, but also to support team, because they can know how the containers look like. The component diagram, this is a deep in the container, and it shows how the containers are implemented. This is more specific for programmers and architects. And the last one, the code one, where we see how it's implemented the functionality. These kind of diagrams usually are provided by IDEs, so nobody will start and write this kind of diagrams. The question is there other solution for documenting our architecture? And the answer is yes, using the code documentation. For this, I choose ArchUnit. I found about ArchUnit relatively soon. I started to work with it, but I knew for some time. And so what is ArchUnit? How does it work? And how can help us to improve our projects? ArchUnit is a free Java library, simple to use, it's extensible, and originally was created by Peter Garfer. In this moment, it's maintained by TNG Group, and also other members that wants to participate and contribute to that, that code. How does it work? It's analyzing Java bytecode, and it's using any plain Java unit testing framework. For a module overview, the ArchUnit is composed by these four main modules. The ArchUnit is the core of the project. We have a support for JUnit 4, JUnit 5, and also we have a ArchUnit example module, which is very useful, and I recommend you to take a look to it and see how they recommend us to use those rules. The installation also, it's very simple. All you need, if you are using Maven or Gradle, all you need to do is to add the dependency that you want to use. The scope is test, so this will not affect your deployment in production, for example, because this dependency is only for a scope test. And this we see for Artifactory ID, we have JUnit 4. We have JUnit 5 also support, and for other frameworks, we have the core for ArchUnit. And for Gradle, it's also the same dependency, you can see here. So we'll move to a demo, because I've created a project that I hope with could help to understand better how easy it is to use ArchUnit. Okay. So here we have a demo project. It's supposed to be an e-commerce application. For the test purpose, I've created only four module, the main ones. is the customer module that manage all the customer from for the system, the orders that manage all the orders of the system, payment and the product. Now we'll take a look how these modules are implemented. I created this project like I separate them for like a domain where is the core of our application, the DAO, which communicate with our domain, the services, which implement our business logic, and the rest where the controllers are, and they should be interact only with services or other external services from libraries, for example. And here we have a core. We suppose this to be all the application, for example, a monolith, and we want to do some refactoring here. And also it was a core, we started to extract some classes from this, but we couldn't extract all of them, and some packages and classes still need to be in our project, like the events one. We want to move maybe into microservices for events, and in this moment they are still here. And also the other module follows the same scenario in this case, but can be different also. And what I've done, it was under the test, I've created some ArchUnit test, and also we have standard test, could be usually test units. And but before to start and take a look at the how rules are written, let's take a look at the POM that I've created. Here is the parent, and we see all the dependencies that we have, and we'll take a look at the last versions that we are using for for ArchUnit. I'm using with J4, or the example are based on J4, and also I've added some usually libraries that most of us have in our projects, like persistence, like Spring Web, Swagger annotation, because maybe we want to have our controllers annotated. Joda time, why not? This is a Java 8 version that I'm using for this project, and also other dependencies. Now let's take a look at the product. I have all the dependencies here, and we want to take a look at ArchUnit test. ArchUnit tests are usually written using this pattern. We have a predicate and we have a condition. How ArchUnit works, we have the core file, the core class, which is a class file importer, and tell us from where ArchUnit should import our classes in our Java classes. And for this example, I'm using the product. So when this line of code will be run, we'll import all our classes from this product packages, and we can apply rules for these classes. The rules that I apply here, I've created, like you can see from here, classes that suggest our annotation, class containment, class cycle, general coding rules that we will pass through and see how what their contains. And this reason this rules is something like entities should be annotated with entity and table annotations, because in most of the cases, this is the scenario. We are using entities, and we need to annotate them with entity and table from Java's persistence. Now we'll build the project. And we'll see that everything should be okay. Okay. The build is green. And in this moment, what I want to do is to invalidate one of these rules. And in the product entity, I will comment the entity annotation. I will not run all the project again because it's time consuming at this moment. In their documentation, you can see how you can improve the build and what supposed and how they are maintaining all the classes in memory. It's very interesting, and I recommend you to test to read that documentation. And in this moment, we'll execute only this class. And like we can see here, this rule was violated. This is the term that they are using. And also, like we can see, the messages are very user-friendly. And there are different ways of writing the code. Because the time it's short for this presentation, I want to let you know what you can find in this project, because it's on GitHub, and you can take it and take a look of all the rules that I've created, and also I've tried to put them in some in this way, in such a way that can be easy integrated in a project. This was for a entity, for class, for packages, and so on. I've created the rules using names for classes, created names like package containment, package dependencies, and so on. But a best practice is to use this ArchUnit test using a specific class that you want to test. For example, you want to test all the DAOs, and here you'll write the rules that applies to all the DAOs from this package. You can create entity rules, and here I've created a rule for entities, for example, because we had this kind of issue in our environments. The main reason was that some entities were created without an ID, a primary key, and this could create the performance issue, and this can be enforced on the ArchUnit rules, and all the entities should have an ID that should be generated, and if someone new in our project creates a entity that doesn't respect these rules, the build will fail. And also, it's easy to find out on the build. This can also miss on the code review. So we'll take a look at these rules. We'll run it, and after that, we'll go to the final slide and also the the question section. Here I've created all these rules, but we cannot run it. We should have run from here. You should specify run with and analysis classes. This will be analysis from the customer. We'll run this. we see that all the rules are green. Let me close other files. Go back to entity. And we should have the customer entity. And here, for example, we'll comment the generated. And we'll run this again. And that rule should be violated. Yeah, like you can see here. And also you can apply your rules for plant UML. You can write use rules for your resources, for services, like general rules you can create, for example, to not to use login file. These are embedded in ArchUnit code. You could, you can choose to not to use JODA time, and here you can document your reason why this should not be using JODA time. Okay, we'll go to the last slide. And why should we use ArchUnit? Because it allows us to define our best practices and architecture rules. The decisions are documented with a reason. ArchUnit provides you an API that it can tell you why those rules were created and why should not be violated. The violations messages, like I said, are very descriptive and human readable. Rules are checked as part of our usual run, so we don't need to have any pipe created. So it's very easy. You can know when we'll run the build before to push it on your repository that some of the rules are not respected. Okay, I don't want to. So if there are any other questions, this project is also on GitHub. This is the link, and you can download it and do your thing and do your own ArchUnit rules, because it would help you.
Thank you very much, Georgia, for the nice presentation. I have one question for you, if I may.
Sure.
If you could pick one main asset for ArchUnit, what would that be?
This is a difficult question, because it's difficult to pick only one.
The most important one, the most representative one.
I would say the easy mode to write rules, because the language is self-descriptive, and you can write the rules in a fluent language. So this would be my first pick to say, but also there are any other assets that we should use.
Fluent language sounds good for me as well, because it means it can be used by almost everybody.
Exactly.
That's a good advantage.
And, well, and understood also.
Whoa, very important point. Very important point. Thank you very much, Georgia. Thank you very much for the nice presentation. Thank you very much, everybody, for listening to us and being here with us. I would.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you. And I would kindly ask everyone to move on to the next session in half a minute. See you there. Thank you, Georgia. Have a nice day.
You too. Bye.